morning to all of you. So this is the first of the series of workshops that we want to organize. As you know, this NCCRD is a national center where we have the latest diagnostic instruments. And to give a fillip to the combustion research, we thought that we'll conduct these workshops one after another in various topics. The first one is on hot wire measurements. So today we have four lectures on various aspects of hot wire measurements, and tomorrow we have the demos of the corresponding ones. So the first lecture is on the basics. So before we go to turbulent measurements by hot wire, let me give a brief idea about turbulence itself. All of you know that in turbulent flow there are random fluctuations. Random fluctuations in all the velocity components, pressure, and let's say if the problem involves some heat and mass transfer, then fluctuations in temperature, fluctuation in concentration, species concentration, etc. will be there. And what are causing these fluctuations? Obviously, there are eddies, and small and big, and these eddies create the fluctuations. I mean, they are of course carried with the mean flow, and if an eddy passes at a particular location, it creates a flutter or creates a fluctuation in any quantity like velocity or pressure or temperature or whatever. The question is, how did these eddies come about in the first place? In a turbulent, you know that, for example, the famous experiment by Osborne Reynolds, I think it was towards the end of 19th century that he did it, and he was visualizing the flow in a pipe, and in fact, he saw that at low flow rates, the dye that was injected was going without any disturbance in a smooth way. So obviously, we know it as laminar flow now. And as the flow rate increased, he found that there were sort of forming eddies, and then it was not a smooth flow. In those days, they called it a sinuous flow. Of course, we call it as a turbulent flow now. And in fact, he did the experiment both ways, by increasing the flow rate as well as decreasing the flow rate, and he found that there was a difference. There is a critical condition at which the transition takes place from laminar to turbulent. And now, of course, we, in terms of the number, Reynolds number, was in honor of Reynolds himself. So we know that for a pipe flow, roughly in the range of 2000, the transition takes place. But if you see it more carefully, it happens over range, something like 1700 to 2300 in general. But I said in general because it is possible that even at higher Reynolds number, even at 3000, 5000, etc., under very carefully monitored conditions, you can maintain laminar flow. It is possible. All right? But only thing is, it will be so sensitive to disturbance that if somebody sneezed or somebody just walked by, there is a possibility it may undergo transition. So what it means is that the transition from laminar to turbulent is an instability, and basically it happens at high Reynolds number flow, and high Reynolds number means the ratio of inertial to viscous forces is high, and you know, inertial forces are nonlinear, rho u square, right? So the slightest disturbance will tend to grow in a nonlinear way, and eventually it will end up with some kind of instability, and in this case the instability will result in the formation of many vortices, small and big, which are transported along with the flow. And those vortices are the ones which create the fluctuations, right? So if you say that in laminar flow, velocity, let's say in the x direction, will be u bar plus u prime, or in the y direction will be v bar plus v prime, or in the z direction, w bar plus w prime, etc. All those fluctuations are coming from the eddies which are, those are the ones which cause the fluctuations. And one more thing that happens is that it is not that these vortices, once formed, they remain as they are. There are dynamic interactions. It can happen that two vortices may coalesce to form larger vortex, or a large vortex may break up into smaller ones. So the eddy breakup or coalescence processes will take place, and after some time you will see that there is a whole population of eddies present. This happens with any population for that matter, whether it's human population, animal population, whatever, that you find that small ones to old ones, there is a whole range of things. So in turbulent flow also you will see that a whole range of eddy sizes will exist. In fact, in a fully developed turbulent flow, the scales, I mean the sizes of the eddies can go 10 power 5 or 10 power 6. can be the ratio. That is 1 to a micron size to even a meter size. It's possible. You can have eddies of all sizes. We have a speaker from IISc Bangalore, Professor Ramesh. So he will be giving the lecture in the afternoon. Yeah. So he has consented to give the lecture. He has come for our purpose only. Anyway. So the, as I mentioned here, the vortices will through coalescence or breakup processes, finer scale. The term scale is used to indicate the eddy sizes. So fine scale means small eddy, the large scale means larger eddies, and so on. And the in turbulent flow, when all these various eddy sizes are present, the large size eddies, which are also called as integral scales, these are responsible for good mixing in turbulent flow. But anybody knows that if you, for any transport, whether it is heat transfer, mass transfer, whatever, increases in turbulent flow as compared to laminar flow. Even the shear stresses will be larger, because what happens is the momentum is mixed very well. So if you look at pipe flow, turbulent pipe flow, the velocity profile will be almost uniform in the central part over a large distance. Only near the wall you have a very sharp gradient. So this, the mixing which occurs because of the eddy large integral scales present, so that obviously will increase all transport rates, momentum or energy or species or whatever. Whereas at the other end of the spectrum, the small scales, also known by the name of Kolmogorov, I think he has contributed quite a bit to the turbulence research. So they are responsible for dissipation of kinetic energy as heat. So in fact, I would rather put it like this, just to give an example. We are very familiar in India with corruption, that so there is a parallel economy happening. So what happens is, what happens here is that the activities that happen in the regular economy, some of it gets siphoned into the other one, and finally it gets dissipated somewhere. So we can say that turbulence, something similar happens, that the large eddies which are there, they extract momentum from the main flow, and that is transferred from the large scale to smaller ones, sounds, etc., up to almost the Kolmogorov scale, at which finally it is dissipated as heat. So there is some kind of a parallel in that. And one more thing that one can understand is that dissipation happens mainly at the smallest scale. Alright? In between, it is almost like transferring. Now, there is hardly any dissipation. So it goes from, let's say, across the eddy sizes. We will see a graph about that a little later. One more thing, a very, very important thing about turbulent flow is that in a fully developed turbulent flow, it's a kind of universal state. There is no memory of how it started. See, we said that the laminar to turbulent flow itself is a kind of transition, or it's a kind of instability that grows. And you can initiate, let's say, the vortices can be generated by any mechanism. You can put cylinders can have vortices which are shed, and after some distance those vortices may break up or coalesce and a whole spectrum can evolve. You can put a mesh. Mesh also can create eddies depending on the size of the mesh. After a while, those, you know, through the dynamic interactions between the vortices can eventually end up with some kind of a whole spectrum. The wall of any geometry, pipe flow or flow or a plate or whatever, you know that by any machining process you cannot make a surface very smooth. There are always undulations, right, of the order of maybe few microns. So those undulations can also create disturbances, and those disturbances in turn can grow, and finally it can result in a whole spectrum of eddy sizes. So the vortex generators can be anything, can be a mesh, can be wall, the roughness of the wall, it can be some kind of bluff body which is there, whatever, right. So what you will see is that, for example, if I keep cylinders, a row of cylinders, and then vortices are shed, if you measure immediately in the wake of the cylinder, you will see that the vortices which are there retain memory of the fact that they were generated by the cylinder. The sizes of the eddies average will be, let's say, dimension of the cylinder itself. But as you go further and further away, finally if it develops into a whole spectrum, you won't even know whether there was any cylinder at all, in a sense that a universal state will develop, right? Depending upon the let's say the overall Reynolds number of the problem, you may have some kind of a universal state emerging, whereas during transition from laminar to turbulent flow, some of the large initial scales may retain memory of the initial state. So that is another distinguishing feature between, let's say, one may ask a question. There is, let's say, vortex shading behind a cylinder. All right? Let's say if the Reynolds number is low enough, you may have even periodic vortex shading. One can ask a question. Okay, there are vortices. Can we call it a turbulent flow? All right? To that question, the answer is no, because if you have periodic vortex shading, there is only one frequency present. Maybe some harmonics of that may be present. It is still not turbulent flow. Turbulent flow would imply that you have to have the entire whole spectrum should be there. So, and a universal state should be there, which has nothing to do with the initial thing that generated. So, one more important aspect is that you will have all the fluctuations, the x, y, z direction, u prime, v prime, w prime, etc., the root mean square values will tend to become equal, although initially this may not be the case. In fact, many situations you may find in the main flow direction, the fluctuation may be larger in size. For example, you are doing measurements in a jet flow. So in the flow direction, the fluctuation u prime may be larger in magnitude as compared to v prime, w prime, etc. But after a while, you will see that it will become isotropic. And also, the distribution itself, if you plot it, right? Any distribution can be plotted, the number of occurrences versus the amplitude, etc. If you do that, magnitude, that will form some kind of distribution. In a fully developed turbulent flow, you will see it becomes Gaussian. Why Gaussian? Gaussian, basically, any random process, right? Perfectly random process will tend to occupy, will have a kind of Gaussian distribution. So you will see that in a fully developed situation, the distribution will become Gaussian as well. Whereas the Gaussian distribution may not, for example, I am just giving an example here. Suppose you have a jet flow like this, and if you were to measure the fluctuations in the initial region, very often, of course, where are these fluctuations coming from in the case of a jet flow? There are instabilities, right? The shear layer instabilities, which can create fluctuations of certain frequencies. We will see very shortly something about that. And those in turn slowly can become broader and broader. The spectrum can become broader and broader, and all scales may evolve. And even then, for quite some distance, you may find that the x direction fluctuations are larger in size than the y and z direction. But far away from the origin, you will find that the all fluctuations, u prime, v prime, w prime, all become essentially equal, and it also tends to become a Gaussian type of distribution. Yeah. In the case of, let's say, from wall, it is said that the eddies may burst, from the turbulent burst can occur, and but later on, the eddy sizes, depending on the location from the wall, you may have large eddies away from the wall, and very close to the wall, the eddy sizes may be very small. In fact, we have shown as if there will be some undulations here. So depending on those undulations, some micron size eddies may be present. But very often, their effect is so small, almost this flow can be considered to be like a laminar type of flow with very little mixing due to turbulence. But as the eddies move away from the wall, they extract energy from the main flow and tend to become larger and larger in size. And as we said, those integral scales, the larger eddies are the ones which are responsible for good mixing. And you will find that in a turbulent boundary layer, this profile is almost very slowly varying. In fact, this will be like a logarithmic profile, but very close to the wall will be a very sharp, even this is not a representative one, very, very sharp kind of variation will be there. Yeah, this just shows some measurement done in our lab on the shear layer instability in a jet flow. So these are all vortices which are formed, and you see that there is some, after forming, slowly they tend to increase in size, etc. That's also happening. And in some very interesting thing you will see here, two eddies are tending to merge, and finally, so later the kind of coalescence of eddies is happening. So this is with respect to time. You find that even though vortices may be generated by any kind of mechanism, maybe shear layer instability, or maybe as I said undulations near the wall or a mesh, or maybe a cylinder which is placed in a flow, whatever be the cause of the initial vortex generation, but after a while those can interact by coalescence, they can become larger, or by breakup they can become smaller, etc. So you will have a whole range which is evolving. Okay, this is a typical the energy spectrum that is discussed in any turbulent flow. This L0 represents the size of let's say the integral scale. There are again further divisions, Taylor microscale, macroscale, etc. There are various things which are talked about. Then there is an initial sub range where in fact the slope of the curve will be -π/3. Of course, what is plotted here is a wave number. If you want to know what is wave number is essentially, if you take unit length, how many waves are there, all right, that is wave number. So wave number is plotted here. It has dimensions of length inverse. So L0 inverse, or LK, K represents the Kolmogorov scale, length scale, so LK. So wave number is plotted here, and the energy is plotted here. So in this distribution you see that this portion of the curve, I would say, depends on the problem. It is not universal, depends on the problem. If you generated the vortices from cylinder or maybe something else, this part could be different. But once you reach this portion and the subsequent one, that is universal. All right. So whatever be the problem that you are having, all right, the inertial subrange and finally the Kolmogorov, so this entire thing will be sort of universal, but this portion depends upon the problem that you are dealing with, whether you are dealing with flow behind cylinders, or maybe boundary layer over the wall, etc. So depending upon what is the problem, this portion can be different. Another important thing that I mentioned, okay, these large scales are the ones which extract the energy from the mean flow. All right, obviously the eddies are also exchanging energy with the mean flow, so they can their momentum, eddy momentum, is basically coming from the mean flow only. But afterwards, this is essentially a cascade in which without much dissipation the energy gets from the larger scale to the lower, smaller ones, so it just keeps going. Somewhat like, you know, again to give an example, one man earns a lot of money and keeps it, and maybe a few people just retain it, all right, without any. But finally one fellow like me will come and spend the whole thing, right? So that's where the dissipation happens. The dissipation happens at this level, the Kolmogorov scale, right? But during the inertial subrange, there is hardly any dissipation of energy, but it is transferred across. So some of these ideas are very useful even in modeling. A typical, let's say, hot wire data, and so of course here time is in tens of milliseconds, so 10, 20, 30, 40 milliseconds, etc. So you find fluctuations of all kinds here, and a lot of processing can be done. Of course there is some mean value of something like 1.48 meter per second, over that there is a fluctuation. And if you plot it over time scale of the order of seconds, you will find this fluctuation all will be like very, very closely spaced fluctuation. We have just expanded it with time of the order of like 10 milliseconds. What are the different methods of velocity measurement, and why are we talking about hot wire, right? There are different methods for measuring velocity, even starting from the Pitot static tube. Of course, Pitot static tube, everybody knows the principle. The flow is brought to stagnation here in an isentropic manner. So the pressure here will become the total pressure P0, and that is communicated to, let's say, a manometer, maybe an electronic one or whatever. And whereas the annular region, the average static pressure at that place, P infinity, is transmitted. And knowing this difference, P infinity and P0 and P infinity, you can calculate the velocity using the Bernoulli's equation. Of course, here it has been assumed that the level z is same, and in any case for gas flow that hardly plays any role. So from here we can measure the velocity u infinity. Question is, can I use the Vitot static tube for turbulence measurement? Mean velocity there is no problem, all right, except for very very low velocities, maybe 0.1, 0.2 meter per second. In that case the pressure difference may be so small, unless you have appropriate instrument to measure low differences in pressure, there may be some difficulty, but otherwise there is no problem in measuring mean velocity. This of course assumes incompressible flow. And the fluctuations, can we measure the fluctuations? The answer is, it can measure oscillations of the order of few hertz maybe, you know, but not more. And turbulence research, you will require almost 0 to 1 megahertz kind of range, at least few hundred kilohertz range is necessary. So obviously Vitot tube is not useful, it can only be used for measuring mean flow velocities. This is laser Doppler velocimeter, a dual beam, which is shown here. So a laser taken from a laser source is split into two beams, and those are focused onto a region which is of interest to us. In that region, of course, you'll have particles, you know, seed particles will be there. Those seed particles will scatter the light. So the scattered light from that region, from the seed particle, will be again received and then finally focused onto a photo detector. And of course, following this photo detector, you will have other electronic equipment also to measure the frequency shift and so on. This is based on the Doppler frequency shift. I don't know how many of you have noticed this. If you go to a railway station and the train is giving a siren, if it is coming towards you, the frequency will be high, whereas if it goes away from you, the frequency will go down. So it will be as if going high pitch and suddenly coming down. The high pitch will be there when train is coming towards you, but when it goes away from you, the pitch will go down, frequency will be less. So it's the same effect which is used here, that when particles are scattering light, depending on whether the particle is coming towards you or going away from you, there will be a shift, frequency shift. If that frequency shift can be measured, from the frequency shift, we can get the velocity. In fact, the formula for the Doppler shift, delta F Doppler, is given as, if there is a velocity of the source which is scattering, in this case this is a scattering particle, seed particle, a seed particle which is scattering the light, that has, let's say, velocity v, and the two beams, which are the beam 1 and beam 2, so between those directions, the resultant will be x, let us say. So the Doppler shift is given by v dot x into 2 sine gamma by 2 by lambda. Gamma is the angle between these two beams, and lambda is the wavelength of the light. What is the wavelength? Anybody has any idea for optical beams? 0.4 to 0.6 micron, all right? Okay, let's even say it's like 1 micron. So if I have something like 1 micron here, and these angles are all, usually these angles are very small, even if I put a value of something like 0.1 here, and then a velocity of the order of few meter per second, you will see that the Doppler shift will be like few hundred kilohertz, or maybe at most a megahertz. All right, that's the kind of shift you will get for measuring the velocity. That is measuring the instantaneous velocity there. But if you have to measure the fluctuation on it, all right? In fact, when you talk about signal processing later, we will show that your sampling frequency has to be higher than the phenomenon that you want to study. Suppose, for example, you want to measure some fluctuation which has a frequency of 100 hertz. You can't sample at 100 hertz. If you sample at 100 hertz, you won't get any. In fact, you'll get a constant value. Just I can even show that if you have, let's say, a wave, let's say it is at 100 hertz, and you take one sample at a time, so it will be like same value. So it will be like a constant. What you measure will be like a constant. So the sampling theorem says that at least you must sample at twice the frequency. So one point here, one point here. In a wave, at least two points must be there to distinguish that there is a wave. All right. So if you want to measure 100 hertz, you should at least sample at 200 hertz. All right. That's still not enough. Two points in a sine wave won't tell you much about the amplitude, etc. preferably 10 times. If I put 10 points in a wave, etc. Suppose this is, let's say I go from here to here. From here to here, let's say some 10 points are there, then you can see that the wave is captured reasonably well. So if I want to measure, let's say 1 megahertz fluctuation, I must sample at 10 megahertz kind of a sampling frequency. But here, as we saw, the Doppler shift itself is of the order of like fraction of a megahertz. So for turbulence research, it can give you up to, let's say, it is said that up to 30 kilohertz you can do, but beyond that, fluctuations may not be sufficient. So what it means is that although LDV can be used for turbulence research, definitely, but still if you want very high frequency response, there is some limitation. Right? Because the wavelength that you use and all the other parameters put in, this Doppler shift will come out to be of the order of few hundred kilohertz. That is for measuring the mean the instantaneous velocity. We are talking about fluctuation there, and the fluctuation let's say frequency of the order of few hundred kilohertz. So there will be some limitation even for LDV with respect to resolving high frequency fluctuations. Okay, particle image velocimetry is another technique which is being used very much. Particle image velocimetry is useful to get velocity over an entire plane, and this obviously uses you create a sheet of laser, and let's say a plane is illuminated. And on that plane, again, there are particles, seed particles, and those particles, this will have a twin pulse, double pulse. So one pulse followed by another pulse, with the time difference between those two pulses being very, very short, of the order of maybe nanoseconds, etc. So two double pulses are given, and the shift in the position of all the seed particles from the first pulse to the second pulse, it will be like a streak. It will form a kind of streak. So how much distance has been moved from the initial position to the final position, that can be computed, and from that, by dividing by time, you will get the velocity at all those points. So in an entire plane, you can get velocity. If you have stereoscopic setup, then even the third component can be measured to some extent. While the PIV can give you velocity over an entire plane, question is, can we use it for turbulent research? The answer is, you can get mean velocity at many points. You can also get, if you take sufficient number of, let's say, pictures like this, PIV images, alright, sufficient means, normally it is like, I think, although the time difference between two pulses, the double pulse is very, very short, but when is the source ready to give another next pulse, etc., there is some limitation depending upon whether you are a single source or also the data that can be transmitted, because the amount of data which will be there for the signal will be so huge. So even from that data transmission point also, there will be some limitation. So typically, you will not have the kind of frequency response required to to analyze the spectral components of in a turbulent flow. So PAV also, although it can give you RMS data, mean velocity data fairly accurately, but then what is the frequency content of the fluctuations, that still will not be as good as what you can get from a hot wire. So looking at various measurement techniques, Pitot tube, only up to a few hertz, you can measure the fluctuation. PIV, mean flow and RMS values are okay, but then limitations on pulsing frequency, even data transfer, etc., the spectral components may not be resolved with adequate accuracy. LDV and hot wire can provide high frequency response, but hot wire is definitely superior to LDV. We can go to much higher frequencies with hot wire than with LDV. So coming to the hot wire, so how does a hot wire probe look like? Basically there is a wire, a very, very thin wire. This thin wire is, let's say, typically a tungsten wire. It could be coated with platinum or platinum iridium, etc. That is to prevent oxidation. Tungsten is very good with respect to let's say high, it can go up to high temperatures, has good strength and all that, but it also will tend to oxidize. So to prevent oxidation, there will be some coating given. So platinum or platinum iridium coating may be provided here. The size of the wire, typically length will be something between 1 to 2 mm length. Diameter of the order of few microns, 5 microns or less. And the wire is welded at two ends. There is welding equipment available. So you can place the, let's say this is the typical hot wire probe. These are prongs, metallic prongs. Alright, so you can take a wire from a spool and then just spread it across this, and at this end, by providing, you know, with electrodes, you can just give a spark and weld it here and also weld it here. So like this, the wire can be welded on both sides, but to both prongs, using some welding equipment which is available. So once you have done that, this is the hot wire probe, and this will become part of a circuit, a Wheatstone bridge. A bridge circuit will be there. So this will be one of the arms of the bridge circuit, and you will provide current through this. So the wire will get heated. So when it gets heated, the heat of course will be dissipated to the ambient. For example, if there is an air flow, so air will be flowing over this wire. As air is flowing, it will take away the heat. Now using the heat transfer correlation between the wire and the air, it is possible to measure the instantaneous velocity. When I say instantaneous velocity, both the mean component as well as the fluctuation. In fact, we can go to frequency responses. Hot wire is excellent, excellent. I mean, nothing to really anywhere close to it. You can get frequency response out of several hundred kilohertz, almost touching a megahertz for the fluctuation itself. So this shows the circuitry for just a schematic diagram. So this is the hot wire probe. So the wire is the probe basically. This is the prong, and finally it is connected as an arm of a bridge circuit. All of you, I am sure, would have studied about the Wheatstone bridge. There are four resistances. So the wire is one of them, and there is a kind of comparator circuit here. It's also a kind of feedback circuit, that whenever the resistances are not, let's say, if you if the bridge is balanced, then you will have R1 by R2 equals R2 by R3 kind of. This is, let's say, R by R1, R2 by R3. That kind of ratio will be there when the bridge is balanced. So when let's say if the airflow is having a fluctuation, turbulent fluctuation, then what will happen is that because of the turbulent fluctuation, the wire temperature may change, and the resistance of the wire is a function of its temperature. So if the temperature changes, the resistance will vary. If the resistance varies, then the bridge will go out of balance. Originally, if it had been in balance, because the temperature because of velocity fluctuation, temperature will tend to change. And due to that change in temperature, the resistance will tend to change, etc. So the bridge will go out of balance. But in fact, there are two modes of operation for the wire. One is without feedback, and the other is with feedback. If you did not have any feedback, just dependent only on the response of the wire itself, then typically it will give you frequency response of the order of maybe maximum 1 kilohertz. Alright? This is the response without compensation. So because the wire is very small. In general, for any probe, the smaller the probe, the higher will be the frequency response. This is true even for a thermocouple. I am sure that many of you would have used thermocouples. For a thermocouple, how do we find the time response? You can write a lumped parameter equation, mass into specific heat into rate of change of temperature of the thermocouple equals the heat loss from the thermocouple. Heat loss from the thermocouple is H into heat transfer coefficient into area times temperature difference between the thermocouple and the ambient. It's a first order equation. If you solve that first order equation, you will get an exponentially decaying curve. The exponentially decaying curve, the time constant will depend on the size of the thermocouple. Smaller the thermocouple, smaller will be the time, or higher will be the frequency response. So in a similar way, the wire also, I told you, hot wire, has dimensions, diameter of the order of few microns, length of the order of maybe 1 millimeter, 2 millimeter, in that range. So a small probe like this, the response on its own will be of the order of kilohertz. Right? However, if I provide a feedback, now what this feedback is doing is that this is electrical circuitry, so where you can have very, very high feedback can be extremely fast. So as this temperature tends to change because of the velocity, immediately the circuit will become active. It will, let's say for example, the wire temperature decreases, the circuit will increase the current, correspondingly the voltage, so that the temperature is restored back to the original value. Alright? For example, let's say that if I want to keep the temperature at 250 degrees, alright? I want to keep it at 250 degrees, there is a, due to fluctuation in the airflow velocity, suppose 250 tends to become 249, immediately the circuitry will act and then will increase the current through the wire, corresponding to the voltage also. So once again the temperature will get restored back to the original value of 250 degrees, and at what kind of rates, you will see that the frequency response now becomes more than 100 kilohertz. Usually like 200, 300 kilohertz is very common. Even in very special cases, up to 1 megahertz is possible. That is, within a microsecond or of the order of microsecond, this is the change is immediately restored. Alright? It's brought back to this. So, in fact, this mode is called as constant temperature anemometer, CTA. Constant temperature anemometer, CTA mode. This is a mode in which we normally operate a hot wire to measure the turbulent fluctuations. Whereas this is known as a constant current mode, CCA mode. This is normally not used. It is used only in certain special cases, especially if you want to study the turbulence in non-isothermal flow field, then you need to get some idea about the temperature variation in the, of the flow. For getting the idea of temperature variation of the flow, this CCA mode can be used. Otherwise, the CTA mode is what we normally use, constant temperature anemometer. So the constant temperature anemometer, the bridge will always compare and check whether the resistance is balanced with the others. If there is an imbalance because of velocity fluctuation, due to which temperature will tend to change, due to temperature change, resistance will change, then immediately this feedback circuit will act and increase the current and voltage etc. through the circuit, and by compensating it immediately you will get a, so the wire plus the feedback together, wire has a response of 1 kilohertz, but once you put the feedback it becomes more than 100 kilohertz, almost more than 100 times the response becomes faster. Alright? So this is the hot wire anemometer system operated on a constant temperature anemometer mode. So typical dimensions are given here. You can see the wire diameter is 4 micron, length is 1.25 millimeter, and temperature of the order of 250 degrees. It's a heated wire. Alright? So and whenever there is a, due to velocity fluctuation, if there is a tendency for the temperature to change, it is immediately compensated. When I say compensated, that something would have changed. What will change? The voltage. This feedback circuit will increase the current and correspondingly the voltage. So the voltage will also fluctuate in accordance with the velocity. So if velocity is fluctuating, the voltage across the wire will oscillate because of the feedback. Alright? Yeah. Oh, sorry. Where did it go? Something happened. Okay, right. What we need to do is relate the voltage and the velocity, right? So we have to find some kind of an equation relating, E is the voltage and U is the velocity, so we need to relate them. So in fact this is known by the name King's law, a very simple kind of expression, where E square is the, E is the voltage across the wire and U is the velocity. So typically one can correlate in the form of E square equals E naught square plus B times UN. What is the E naught due to? This E naught is a voltage when the velocity is zero. Why would you have a voltage even if there is no flow? There is loss by natural convection. Alright, even if there is no flow, still the wire will be losing heat by natural convection. So this E naught typically will take care of the natural convection, heat loss by natural convection. Essentially the equation for the hot wire goes like this. The rate of heat loss Q dot equals E square by R. You know, normally we use V as the voltage, but somehow the literature E has been preferred. So E is the voltage across the wire. So E square by R is the heat loss through the wire, rate of heat loss through the wire. This can also be equated to heat transfer coefficient H into surface area of the wire into the temperature difference between the wire and the fluid, Tw minus Tf. So in these, the parameter that is sensitive to velocity is the heat transfer coefficient. You know that heat transfer coefficient can be found out from the Nusselt number correlation. So Nusselt number equals Hd by Kf, d is the diameter of the wire, Hd by Kf is the conductivity of the air. So this Nusselt number has a correlation of the form, some constant times Reynolds number to the power n, Prandtl number to the power m. And Reynolds number itself can be expanded as velocity into diameter by the viscosity, and so on. The question is, okay, what is this power n? Typically, what do you expect the power to be? Please remember that although the flow is turbulent, but in the length scale of the wire itself, it is like a laminar flow. If you look at the Reynolds number for the wire, we said that diameter of the wire is like microns, right? 5 micron, 4 micron, something like that. So you take, let's say, a few meters per second of velocity, take the diameter of the wire, calculate what is the Reynolds number. Reynolds number may be like 40, 50, low value, right? So it is still like a laminar flow. For laminar flow over a cylinder, etc., in the boundary layer thickness, how does the boundary layer thickness vary with Reynolds number? It will be 1 by square root of Reynolds number. Eventually, the heat transfer coefficient will be proportional to Re power half because of this. Okay. So you will see that even for hot wire, although the overall flow may be the turbulent flow, all right, but the wire dimension is so small, it is of the order of diameters of the order of micron. In fact, the wire can be taken as an infinite cylinder. See, with 1.25 mm and 4 micron diameter, if you take the ratio, ratio of the length of the wire to diameter, all right, that ratio will come out to be almost close to 1000. All right. So again, depends on what is the actual diameter, length, etc. About the 400, 500, etc. is very common. So it's like an infinite cylinder. So over, for an infinite cylinder, we have taken the corresponding correlation, heat transfer correlation. And in the correlation, the power n will be close to half, n will be close to half. Typically, when you calibrate a hot wire, this will be between some 0.45 to 0.5. N value will be somewhere between 0.45 to 0.5. And so like that, we see that the heat transfer coefficient is proportional to velocity power half. Right. So if I substitute that, everything else, please remember that the wire itself, the temperature is kept constant. We are operating on a constant temperature anemometer mode, CTA mode. So R is kept constant by the feedback circuit, etc. R is constant. Everything else here, A is a constant, surface area is a constant, wire temperature is a constant. We are assuming ambient fluid temperature is also a constant here, etc. Everything is constant except H. H is a function of velocity. And what function? It will be power 0.5, u power 0.5. So building that in, you can finally get E square as a function of u, so in a form like this. So the voltage square, voltage across the wire is E. E square equals E naught square plus B u power n. If u is fluctuating, E will fluctuate. Right? If the velocity across the wire is fluctuating, then this voltage will fluctuate. So you can measure the voltage, and that, so voltage is, before using the wire for turbulence measurement, we have to get the correlation between the voltage and the velocity for mean flow. All right. So you keep a known flow. All right. How do you create a known flow? One possibility is to use wind tunnel. Have a wind tunnel. In a wind tunnel, create a known velocity. And if you want, you can measure that known velocity even using a hot wire, even using pitot tube. All right? Mean velocity only. You can measure the mean velocity using pitot tube. So, and then corresponding voltage across a hot wire for the velocity value. Suppose velocity is 1 meter per second, what is the voltage? So, like that, for every velocity, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, etc., you measure the velocity, plot it. Mean velocity versus mean voltage, you plot it. So that is the calibration curve, E square versus U, and this follows what is called as a King's law, that is E square equals E naught square plus B U power N. Now the question is, how do I use it for turbulence? How to measure U prime? Then what you can do is, that can be thought of as a perturbation of velocity U. So by slightly perturb the velocity, the voltage also will be slightly perturbed. I can use the something like a Taylor series expansion, or so suppose you differentiate this. Differentiate this, it becomes 2E times dE by dU. I am writing E as a mean value here. Alright. So this also should have been mean. Okay, doesn't matter. All of these are mean values. So 2E dE by dU equals, of course this is the condo, this is gone, B into N into U power N minus 1. Alright. So this is the slope. And then finally arrange it as delta E in terms of delta U using the slope. So the slope is given by B N U power N minus 1 divided by 2 times E. Alright. So that is the slope. From that slope I can say get delta E by delta U. Delta E is the voltage fluctuation, delta U is the velocity fluctuation. So fluctuation, suppose I call it as E prime, delta E I call as E prime, delta U I call as U prime. So E prime and U prime are related by the slope of the curve. So depending on which point you are trying to measure the velocity, suppose for example mean velocity is here, the mean voltage is here, slight perturbation U prime corresponding E prime will be related by the slope of the curve of this curve. So B into N into U power N minus 1 by 2E, that gives you the slope. That slope multiplied by U prime will give you E prime, or rather E prime in terms of that you can get all of these to this side. You measure the voltage fluctuation and get the velocity fluctuation. Velocity fluctuation can be derived. So essentially what happens is you have hot wire, which is a very very sensitive probe, and first calibrate it. During calibration you have to have a known velocity field. That known velocity field can be created with the help of a wind tunnel. So and you can vary the flow rate through the wind tunnel. And to measure the mean velocity you can also have a Pitot tube by the side. So Pitot tube and hot wire are both there. Pitot tube is measuring the mean velocity. Corresponding voltage is measured with the hot wire. You note them down. So from that you construct the calibration curve. Once the calibration curve is constructed, the slope of the calibration curve will give you the relationship between the voltage fluctuation and velocity fluctuation. So calibration in a wind tunnel is shown here. A wind tunnel itself, just to give a brief idea of what a wind tunnel will do. Why do we go for a wind tunnel in the first place? In a wind tunnel, you can create a flow field which has very, very low turbulence and uniform flow field. So it does not matter where you keep the probe, alright. So you create a uniform flow field. To create a uniform flow field, what you can do is, let's say maybe normally you construct a wind tunnel on the suction side of a fan or a blower. So a fan with a motor is here, it will suck the flow. As the flow is being sucked in, there is a kind of bell mouth entry. And then you have a honeycomb to straighten the flow, and there are streams or meshes which will reduce the size of the eddies which can pass by. And finally there is also kind of this converging section, etc., will ensure that eventually whatever flow that emerges here will have very very little turbulence. In fact, a good wind tunnel that is constructed, the fluctuation may be 0.1, 0.2% of the mean, very very low level of fluctuation only will be there. So in that uniform velocity flow field, you can keep a hot wire and a Pitot probe. So Pitot tube will give you the velocity, the hot wire will give the corresponding voltage, mean voltage, in obtain the calibration curve. Of course you may ask, is that the, yeah? How what? How far? They should be as close as possible. Both are small probes only. A few millimeters this way, that way, doesn't matter, because the wind tunnel will have uniform flow. The central, except near the wall. See, near the wall there will be a boundary layer. There will be a boundary layer near the wall. You have to leave the boundary layer region. Anywhere in the middle is okay, because wind tunnel is supposed to have a uniform flow. Alright. In fact, one thing that is normally done to check a wind tunnel, using Pitot tube itself, you just measure across, go across, verify that the flow field is uniform, same velocity is there. Okay, so you can ensure first that the wind tunnel gives you a uniform flow field. Once it is ensured, then there is no problem. Right? Normally it will. If all the screens and everything are all properly done, you will get a uniform flow field here. And that, in that uniform flow field, you can few millimeters separation is not a problem. Right? And then, so by measuring the mean velocity and mean voltage, you can get the calibration curve. But this is not the only way, there are also other ways. Normally, if you buy a hot wire instrument, they themselves will give a calibrating nozzle. Nozzle also, by the way, can produce a known field, right? Of course, in the higher velocity range, 40 meter, 50 meter, 100 meter per second, etc. Nozzle flow equation, no? You have even compressible flow is there, asymptotic compressible flow through a nozzle. If you know the pressure drop across the nozzle, from that you can get the velocity. And good nozzles will also have flow coefficients very close to 1, 0.99 or 0.98, etc. So a nozzle can be used. In the case of a nozzle, if you know the pressure drop across the nozzle, then you know the velocity at the exit section of the nozzle. In that exit velocity region, you can keep the hot wire, and by measuring the delta P across the nozzle, you will know the velocity. So basically, hot wire has to be kept in a known velocity field to get the calibration curve. Calibration curve, you have to know this velocity, corresponding voltage you have to measure, right? So how to create a known velocity is a question. You can do it in a wind tunnel in a simple way, or you can use a calibration nozzle which comes along with the hot wire itself. Another possibility is you have a very good traverse. The traverse moves at a known velocity, that's also okay. But of course, you have to ensure that there is no other motion. It has to be, you know, otherwise the air should be still, right, stationary. Normally this traverse, etc., is employed for very low velocities, 0.5 meter, 0.2 meter, 0.3 meter, etc. You may not be able to use a nozzle, you may not be even with wind tunnel also, it may be difficult. Then a traverse can be used for low calibrating in the low range. Very low velocity range, you may require something like a traverse. Normally wind tunnel with pitot tube, etc., in this range of velocities is very simple, there is no problem. Higher velocities like 50 meter, 100 meter per second, etc., the nozzle, calibrating nozzle can be used. But all the same, at a known velocity, find out what is the hot wire reading, and that gives you the calibration curve. From the calibration curve, as a perturbation, if you look at the velocity being perturbed by U prime, the voltage will become, perturbation will become E prime. E prime and U prime are related through the slope of the curve, and this curve itself is known as the King's law for hot wire measurement. Yeah, of course, if it is just one component of velocity, life is very simple, but unfortunately it is not. Many times you have other components. Even if mean flow may still be one component, the turbulence quantities can be in all directions. Because you know that even in the so-called one-dimensional flow, there are fluctuations in the y and z direction. So V2, V3, etc. will always be there. So the three components, V1, V2, V3, now how does the hot wire respond to it? In fact, the component which is parallel to the hot wire, V2, is very, very not at all effective in removing the heat. After all, the hot wire is based on heat removal or heat loss, right? Now for parallel flow, the heat loss is, the removal is very ineffective. So in fact, it is given by, if you look at it as an effective velocity involving all V1, V2, V3, see whatever we showed in the calibration, suppose I take this as an effective velocity versus the voltage, how to find the effective velocity in case of multidimensional flow? When it has three components, V1, V2, V3, how to find the effective velocity? Now, parallel flow effectiveness for heat removal is very, very small. So, in fact, KT is like 0.2, this effectiveness factor for L by D, L by D of the order of 200, it is like 0.2. But if the L by D ratio becomes 500, 600 or even 1000, this will become almost zero. So for L by D greater than 600, normally KT can be taken to be 0. That is, it is like really like an infinite wire, the tangential one can be neglected, right? V2 can be neglected if the L by D ratio is very large. Now what about, there are two normal components, V1 and V3. What is the difference between them? One component, V1, is normal to the wire but parallel to the prongs. Normal to the wire but parallel to the prongs. V3 is normal to the wire and normal to the prongs. Right? So V1 and V3 are differentiated like that. This component, normal to the wire, parallel to the prongs. this component normal to the wire and normal to the prongs, right? So that is, and in fact this is the component which will least effect of disturbance, because if it is normal means the prongs really don't come in if it is going like that, and so its effectiveness will be more than 1. It is generally in the range of 1 to 1.2, whereas this component is normal to wire, all right, but this presence of the prongs will affect it to some extent, so its effectiveness slightly less compared to this one. So anyway, V1 square, but generally what people assume is that they assume that irrespective of, suppose there is a wire, from whatever direction it is coming, in an axisymmetric way, any direction, effectiveness is same. Whether it is, you know, normal to the wire and parallel to the prongs, and normal to the wire and normal to the prongs, this way or this way, it doesn't matter, all around. In an axisymmetric way, almost in all directions, it's equally effective, it's generally assumed, alright. So, Kn, value of Kn can be taken to be, assumed to be, especially for very long wires. If LBD ratio is very large, this can be taken to be essentially equal to 1, and this can be made to be 0, alright. That depending upon how long the wire is compared to its diameter. Now, we go to use of a cross wire probe, some is also called X probe. That is, there are two hot wires. There is one hot wire like this, there is another hot wire like this, and of course there is some difference between them, that some distance difference will be there, and each of these will have its own prong supported by the probe support, etc. Now I keep a probe like this in a, basically in a two dimensional flow to measure the two mean velocity components and their corresponding fluctuations. The third component unfortunately cannot be measured with the help of the cross wire. It can only measure two components. How do we keep this hot wire? Alright, suppose I have flow like this. How should I keep the wire? You keep the wire in such a way like 45 degrees with respect to the flow. Why do we do like that? Why can't I keep the probe like, you know, like a plus? What will happen is, if we keep like that, if flow is like this, horizontal, and the probe which is horizontal will become ineffective. You know that the parallel flow is ineffective in cooling. So no point in keeping the hot wire probe, the two of the cross wire probe, the two wires are perpendicular to each other, 90 degrees with respect to each other. How to orient them? You'll orient them at 45 degrees to the flow. Alright? The reason is, if you do like that, at 45 degrees, if you keep approximately, both wires are equally effective. Alright? And if you had maintained in such a way that it had been like one is vertical and other is horizontal, in that case what will happen is, when flow is horizontal, one probe will become ineffective. So for equal effectivity, therefore we keep the cross wire at around 45 degrees to the flow direction. And so if the probe is long enough, L by D ratio very large, in that case KT can be taken to be 0. So this tangential component part will go. Then the, only this part, and okay, how did we get that? This depending on the angle alpha, you can resolve it. So there will be V1 cos alpha plus V2 sin alpha, both will be normal to this wire. I think they were also A and B were there. I think one of the wires is A, other wire is B. You can verify what it is. I think it is there in the notes. Unfortunately, in the diagram, A and B are missing. So, A is one wire, B is the other wire. So V1 cos alpha minus V2 sin alpha will be the normal velocity for one of the, for this wire A. V1 sin alpha plus V2 cos alpha will be the normal velocity for the wire B. And so in terms of that, the effective velocity is calculated. And as I said, tangential component can be assumed to be 0 if the LBD ratio is very large, more than some 500, 600, you can take it to be 0. And this Kn also can be taken to be 1 normally for very large LBD ratio. So taking this to be 1, also one more assumption, the flow has been taken to be two dimensional flow, that is, there is no V3 bar is taken to be 0. In that, finally effective velocity will be V1 cos alpha minus V2 sin alpha square plus V3, this is a small v is used for fluctuation. Capital V bar is used for mean velocity. So this is fluctuating component in the third direction. That square plus this square will give you the effective velocity for the probe A. and this is for the probe B. Additionally, if you assume that this is 0, there is no fluctuation in third direction, which is generally not the case. There will be some effect, alright. So you will be approximating that. In that case, the effective velocity will be only this for VA and this for VB. Then what we can do is that by combining these, it is possible to obtain what is the V1 velocity and what is the V2 velocity. Please remember that effective velocity is what we get from the measurement. See, we measure, just going back to calibration. If I measure the voltage for the hot wire, I will get the velocity. That velocity is the effective velocity. If there are two probes, I will get effective velocity for probe A, effective velocity for probe B. From effective velocity, I have to extract V1 and V2. V1 and V2 are the x and y direction velocities. So the x and y direction velocities, you can get them. So from the measured effective velocities for the A probe and the B probe, V1 and V2 can be obtained. Of course, this is assuming 45 degree angle. For cos alpha, sin alpha, etc. are all 1 by root 2. So for 45 degree angle. So finally, we get V1 and V2 in terms of the effective velocities which are measured from the voltages. So this is how a crosswire probe can be used for measuring the velocity. Now we go to some basic, let's say, data processing. Detailed data processing will be done by Senthil. I am not going to that. I am only going to tell you some basic data processing. So the basic data analysis, okay, you have obtained the velocity, instantaneous velocity. From the instantaneous velocity, the mean value can be defined as the integral 0 to t u dt divided by 1 by t. That is, you are measuring by, suppose you measured the data for a time t, capital T. Let us say that I have the hot wire data. Such thing. Let's say I have measured over up to a time period of 0 to t. So t is the maximum duration for which the measurement has been done. So how to get the average? Obviously integrate this and divide by the time. So 1 by t integral 0 to t u dt will give you u bar. And the integral gets replaced by the digital data. After all, you are getting digital data at certain points. So dt by capital T is n. How did I get? See, I'm getting data at regular intervals. Right. So this t equals n number of data multiplied by delta t. So delta t by n is delta t by t equal to 1 by n. So that's what is being shown there. So delta t by t gets replaced by 1 by n. So this becomes, so the average value is nothing but sum of all the digital data over the n samples divided by the number of samples. That will give you the average value u bar, right? Of course, n has to be large enough. So for how long you sample this, just as I was mentioning sometime back, that the sampling rate, sampling frequency has to be at least twice higher than the maximum frequency of interest, alright, at least twice, but preferably 10 times more than the frequency of interest. So how long do you have to sample this? That depends upon the lowest frequency of interest. Suppose lowest frequency of interest is, let's say, 5 hertz. Let's assume. So 5 hertz means your time period is 0.2 seconds. You must get at least one full wave within that. So you must sample at least for 0.2 seconds, preferably more than 0.2 seconds. So suppose you get two waves of the smallest frequency, 5 hertz frequency. 5 hertz means for 0.2 seconds you will have to take it. So preferably something like 0.4 seconds you can measure the data, right? At least two waves inside that. So let's say you sample for long enough time and the time difference between each sample is delta t. So delta t by t is 1 by is n. So 1 by n sigma ui gives you the average value. Then the RMS value, once you have found out the average, you subtract the average from the instantaneous value, subtract the average, u minus u bar gives you the fluctuation, right? So u minus u bar is the fluctuation u prime. So the fluctuation square, fluctuation may be positive or negative, but square is always positive. So you have the u prime square dt integral from 0 to t 1 by t. So this is the basic definition of the RMS value, root mean square value. You find the square, you find the mean square, and then mean square root. So that's why root mean square. So in terms of digital data, dt by capital T becomes 1 by n. And everything else will be, the integral gets replaced by sigma sign. So sigma 1 to capital total number of samples, ui minus u bar. Ui is the instantaneous value of the what you get, a digital data instantaneous value. Ui minus u bar square sigma over I 1 to n 1 by n square root will be the RMS value. I am giving you the definition in terms of the continuous thing as well as in terms of digital data. This is the definition with respect to the continuous data, but really in reality we are using all digital instruments. Digital instruments will sample at certain frequency at equal time intervals. So in terms of digital data, this is what it will be. This is equal to RMS value. Then certain quantities, the cross correlation and auto correlation. If I have two probes, one probe can get u prime value, other probe may get v prime value at a particular instant. So like that, both are, now let's say this is u prime as a function of time. I may have v prime similarly as a function of time, etc. Using two probes, I want to find a cross correlation between them. What is meant by cross correlation and why should we look at it? Although random events or random things may happen, there could be some correlation between them. Just to give an example, let's say rain in Chennai is definitely a random event. I don't even think there is anything to do with monsoon or whatever. So if there is rain and you look at the accidents in the road, accident in the road is also another random event. People drive randomly, so random accidents may happen. So now you try to find the correlation between rain being there and accident happening. You may find that there is a non-zero correlation. Whenever there is rain, there are more accidents probably. Maybe people aren't able to see properly and so on. And road is, friction is not good. So all said and done, so between rain happening and road accident, you may be able to get some correlation. So like that, two random events may be correlated. In this case, u prime and v prime are velocity fluctuations. We are trying to find correlation between them. Of course, this is not as random as what I mentioned, but this u prime and v prime are basically fluctuations coming from essentially the same eddy, if they are coming from, and they will, these will give rise to the Reynolds stresses in the flow field. So u prime, v prime, bar indicates time average over that. So you can define the cross correlation as 1 by t, 0 to t, u prime, v prime, dt. U prime expressed as instantaneous value of u minus the average value, mean value. Similarly, v prime is the instantaneous value of v minus the mean value of v, and this product being summed over all the samples and divided by the number of samples will give you the cross correlation. If this is non-zero, that means the u prime and v prime are correlated, and that will give you at that location essentially the Reynolds stress at that point. Using two probes, one for v, one for u, you will be able to get that. There is something you can do about, there is something called autocorrelation. That is the signal with itself with a slight shift. If I take this signal and let us say that I give a shift tau and then take that part. So this is u of t, this is let's say u of t minus tau. I take this part and try to correlate. That is called autocorrelation. Why are we looking at autocorrelation? I will explain to you very shortly. The autocorrelation, as you see here, u prime of t and u prime of t minus tau dt 1 by t from 0 to t. In all of these, capital T is the total duration for which you have taken the data. and this again in a digital sense can be replaced in terms of this. Because of the shift tau, you have to shift to the I also, I plus M and I plus. So the M times delta T is tau actually. You're shifting by M samples basically. How did it go? Is there something else which must be there? Okay. So this is the autocorrelation basically. I will tell you what is meant by the autocorrelation and where it is used. For example, let's say I put a hot wire probe somewhere and there is a flow and there is an eddy which is passing by. Alright? Now as the eddy is passing by, when the eddy comes to this location, let us say, so the hot wire will start recording for this fluctuations corresponding to this eddy. Alright? Now all these points, they are all parts of the same eddy, but they will cross the hot wire at different times. Alright? So the tau basically that we are talking about is like the shift that I give. Suppose this is t equal to 0, this is a point that comes tau later, a time of tau later. Alright? So whether I take the signal from here, that is u of t, or I take the shifted signal, u of t minus tau, alright? You will find that so long as both the points are of the same eddy, they will remain correlated. So if that's what is showing here. If I take u prime of t with u prime of t itself, with itself, if you take, the correlation will be 1. U prime of t is correlated with u prime of t 100%, right? Whereas if I shift it a little bit by a time interval tau, the time interval tau is basically another point which will be in the same line, it will come to the hot wire little later. Alright. So if I take whether I take the signal from here or whether I take the signal from here, this signal is u prime t, this signal is u prime t of t minus tau. Alright. You will find that both will remain correlated so long as tau corresponds to the distance, I mean the time interval within that eddy. Alright. So, if you plot the autocorrelation, you will find that up to a certain tau, a tau max, there will be non-zero correlation, positive non-zero correlation. Beyond that, it will go to zero. Of course, this value is so small, you can almost treat it as this is a numerical error. You don't have to, negative correlation doesn't mean much. Alright? So, basically beyond this, it becomes zero. So, up to a certain point, there is a non-zero correlation. Beyond that, it becomes zero. Now this time period tau max is approximately the time taken for the eddy to cross the hot wire. Alright? This tau max is a period, that is tau max will be essentially the when this point crosses this, that is the time tau max. If I know the time taken by the eddy to cross the hot wire, then how do we find the size of the eddy? Of course I am sure all of you in school would have studied a problem like this. A train traveling at a speed of some 50 kilometers per hour, an observer is there, it takes some 2 minutes to cross, etc. What is the length of the train? You know the time, you know the velocity of the train, multiply, you get the length. Right? Same way, you can get the size of the eddy. The size of the eddy is L. So L will be tau max into u bar. So that's what is shown there. Tau max into u bar gives you the size of, so this will give the size of the integral scale. The average large eddies, their size can be found out like this. So for that autocorrelation is used. So what we see is that the basic data processing of mean value, RMS value, cross correlation, autocorrelation, etc. Autocorrelation is used to find the size of the integral scales. Cross correlation is used to find the Reynolds stresses and mean and RMS values. RMS will give you what is the typical fluctuation there. So this divided by this will be called as turbulence intensity. URMS by U bar will be turbulence intensity. So these are some of the basic data that you can get from processing the test. I think with this more or less I have concluded my lecture. Yeah. So we have given a basic description of what is turbulence, how to use hot wire anemometer for as a powerful tool for experimental research. As compared to other modern instruments like PIV, LDV, etc. Hot wire scores in terms of its high frequency. The high frequency response is given due to two things. One is the size of the wire itself being very small, diameter of micron size, length of millimeter size, that itself gives a very high response. Secondly, there is a feedback circuit sitting on it. That feedback circuit increases the frequency response by more than a factor of 100. So the wire itself has a kilohertz frequency, then that becomes more than 100, few hundred kilohertz is very, very common. In fact, in our lab, what we have is like 300, 400 kilohertz frequency response is there. With the even better things, you can go up to almost a megahertz. One major problem with hot wire is it requires frequent calibration. Why? Because the hot wire is exposed to the atmosphere. Temperatures are the 250, 300 degrees. Some slight oxidation will always be there. So the wire gets deposited by oxide, and sometimes even dust, etc. may settle down. So due to that, the calibration will keep shifting. You attain calibration, it won't remain. After 2-3 days, you have to calibrate once again. So normally, you calibrate it, maybe you try 2-3 times a week, if you want very accurate accuracy. But you will find that shift is only slight, little bit of shift may be there, but it's important to calibrate as many times as possible. Some people even calibrate, when going to do the experiment in the afternoon, morning they'll calibrate and use it for afternoon. So frequent calibration is necessary for accurate. Okay. With this, I'll stop. If there are any doubts, yeah. No, we don't have to do anything. You keep measuring for a long time. The T, no? Time T, total time, you must select suitably. We are not doing it for 180. All right? You have to do over many, some AD will be like this, some AD will be like this, and so on. What we get will be an average size. Please remember that all these L0, etc. are all measures. All right? It is like saying that an average Indian has a height of 5 feet 6 inches. All right? It's like that. It's an average. All right? So you have to take sufficient time. Right? So, for example, let's say the integral scale in a particular problem, let's say is of the order of millimeters. Right? So, millimeters means it may have a frequency like maybe 100 hertz, 200 hertz, something else. Your time should be taken long enough to include eddies like this. We don't know when the eddy will actually come and go. We don't even know. You measure for a long time. Within that time, these eddies will pass. In fact, it is, really speaking, this time should be infinity. You measure for an infinite time, right? Within that, quite a few eddies will pass through. You take an average. And also, many of these should not be done with just one measurement. You have to repeat that measurement again and again several times, and an average of that you will get for that particular process. You are studying flow or maybe some mixing layer, some flat plate, something. Maintain that condition, measure for sufficiently long time, and you measure it for sufficiently long time, then eddies of all sizes will pass through the hot wire at a particular location. Maybe if you say mixing layer, maybe from the middle plane or whatever from the wall, at that location itself you have to measure sufficient number of times and taken. Right? So what is done is you take windows of that, using that window you do, but several times you do it and get them. No. 45 degrees will give you equal. See, you have two wires. You should use them effectively.
Yes, sir.
See, if I have two people to do the job, I will not dump all the work on one person and leave the other person free. Right? I should use both the people equally. Right? So, if two wires are there, try to use them equally. So, if you make it, if the flow is like this and I put a cross wire like this, the perpendicular wire will be very effective. The parallel wire will have no effective use at all. So, we don't want that. That is why. There is nothing which will, it's not mandatory, right? You don't have to keep it 40 degrees. It can be 40, it can be 60, no problem. But if you make it at 9, that is, one wire becomes parallel, otherwise perpendicular, one wire will lose effectivity completely. That's all.
Sir, for that, we have to ensure the flow should be in one direction before.
No. If you don't know, approximately is enough. I'm not saying 45 degrees should be exact. Not necessary. Approximately is enough. That is why we are given in terms of angle alpha. The expression given in terms of angle alpha is for that reason only. Besides, See, when you measure the mean velocity, you can also rotate the probe. If you bring it to such a level that one mean velocity is zero, then you know that the other direction is the flow direction. With respect to that flow direction, keep it at 45 so that both probes are equally effective. You don't have to. It doesn't have to be 45, it can be 40, 60. But if you make it like one probe is parallel, other probe is perpendicular, the parallel probe will be in effect.
Actually, we are averaging the velocity through the length of the wire, so it has very
poor spatial. No, it's an infinitely long wire. The end effects will come, see, in a wire, end effects will be like one or two diameters. This wire is, you know, like 800 diameters long, one or two diameters this way, that way, you know. That is why when you make the wire longer and longer, the KT, etc. is built in. The end effect is built into that.
So if it is too long, so how can I differentiate the velocity at this point and this point?
That is why it's about order of millimeter. Wire length is of the order of millimeter. See, over the order of millimeter, it is an average over that. See, these properties can be assigned to the middle of the wire. If you want very fine measurement, then you traverse it. And so you can take whatever measurement you do can be taken to be appropriate for the middle of the wire. Wire length itself is about a millimeter only. See, any physical probe has to have a dimension. If not, it cannot be a point in space.
Sir,
with
the correlation, I have one doubt. Like, you have
plotted
the
AP
versus time, but
E max
is.
No, tau. No, it is the autocorrelation is a function of tau. It is A of tau. It is A of tau. That is, it is a function of the shift, time shift. Alright? So up to a certain value of shift, A of t is non-zero, A of tau is non-zero. Beyond a certain tau, it becomes zero. That maximum tau up to which it remains non-zero represents the time taken for the AD to pass. So long as both points are part of the same AD, the signal will correlate. Okay, just to give you another example, let's say a car is vibrating, or a car body is vibrating, you are measuring the vibration. Right, you measure at point A, point B, both are in the same car, you will find a correlation. Alright, but suppose something else, the pump is vibrating and car is vibrating, you put one probe here, one probe here, they will not be correlated at all. Right, because they don't belong to the same body. It is like so long as the points taken are to the same thing, you will find them. So the tau max represents the limit, the time shift up to which correlation exists, that represents the size of it, the time taken by the AD to pass by. And if you know that time, multiply by the average velocity that place, it will give you. Yeah.
So
you have to have accurate traverse, etc. You have to have. No, that you have to, with traverse, and there are accurate traverses available. So you from taken from some location, maybe from the axis or from the wall, you should know the distance. So it has to be, all of these are, see, hot wire will give you point wise measurement. At that location, whatever is the fluctuation, its RMS value, its autocorrelation, its cross correlation, everything at that location. At another location, if you want it, you have to traverse and take the probe to another location and note down the location, etc., using the traverse. You see, the disturbance will come after the wire. Before the wire, it will not be. So, until the time the flow is passing over the hot wire, the probe is also designed in such a way that they are all minimum. And in any case, all the disturbances are built into the correlation. The calibration that we do has everything, right? The calibration takes care of it. Disturbance due to the probe support, etc. is already in the correlation. We are correlating with the support, with everything, right? Yeah. You take the velocity, known velocity. For the known velocity, that voltage, with the probe support, with everything, it is done. But the probe itself is designed in such a way that the disturbance ahead is minimum, afterwards there will be, but you don't worry about what is happening afterwards.